Blackstone Publishing presents Ruby Falls, a novel by Deborah Goodrich Royce. This book is read by Stephanie Willis. To Anna, Lisa, Howard, and Grant, all gone too soon. It was an honor to walk with you for a way when we were young in Hollywood. I stand amid the roar of a surf-tormented shore, and I hold within my hand grains of the golden sand. How few, yet how they creep through my fingers to the deep, while I weep, while I weep. Oh God, can I not grasp them with a tighter clasp? Oh God, can I not save one from the pitiless wave? Is all that we see or seem but a dream within a dream? A Dream Within a Dream, Edgar Allan Poe, 1809 to 1849. It is the nature of grief to keep its object perpetually in its eye, to present it in its most pleasurable views, to repeat all the circumstances that attend it, even to the last minuteness, to go back to every particular enjoyment, to dwell upon each, and to find a thousand new perfections in all that were not sufficiently understood before. In grief, the pleasure is still uppermost. A philosophical enquiry into the origin of our ideas of the sublime and beautiful. Edmund Burke, 1729 to 1797. Prologue. Then. 1968, Lookout Mountain. I was standing with my father in the pitch black dark, the blackest dark I'd ever seen in the few short years of my young life, and the blackest dark that I've seen since, which is a considerably longer span. The surrounding air was dank with flecks from falling water. A disembodied voice rose up from the mist, then swooped back down to submerge in it. First amplified, then muffled, the sounds changed places, each taking its turn at prominence. The drone of the voice, the roar of the falls, and the clammy damp came at me from all directions, from the sides, from above and below, to seal me in a viscous coating and stick me to my spot. The waterfall could have been anywhere. Next to me? Yards away? I dared not move a muscle. The woman's words transfixed me with a tale of scuba divers, fearless swimmers who, over the years, had plumbed the depths of a fathomless pool. In wetsuits and tanks, in masks and flippers, down they had plunged into icy water in an effort to find its bottom. No search had been successful. The roiling cascade dropped into a lake that continued, it seemed, to the center of the earth. To China. To horrible depths my imagination was fully engaged in conjuring. Cold drops of perspiration ran down my face, my arms, and the back of my neck. I was concentrating hard, trying to locate the source of her voice, trying to pinpoint the crash of the falls, trying not to move and tumble in, and trying most heartily not to be afraid. When my father let go of my hand. That was it, really. That was all he did. He loosened his hand from my grip, and he disappeared, never to be seen again, while the tour guide never stopped talking. July the 12th, 1968, the last day I saw my father. James Emerson Russell was sunny to most, from the sun in Emerson, I imagine, or maybe from his position in his family of origin. I don't really know. He was just daddy to me, what a little girl calls her father. He was handsome, that Sonny. It is not just my memory, it is what people still say when they don't stop themselves from talking about him. And they say it just like that. He was handsome, that Sonny. I'll grant him that. As though his visage were something they grudgingly bestowed on him. Then they changed the subject on seeing me. He was long and lanky, 6 feet even, impossibly tall to me then. A slight stoop to his walk, crinkly blue eyes, and a halfway receding hairline. His taste in attire ran to Western, and that was how he was dressed that last day. Jeans and a checkered shirt. Madras, my mother had called it. Snaps down the front and a turned-up collar. Cuffed sleeves rolled up to reveal strong forearms, all covered in downy blonde fuzz. He wore cowboy boots and he carried a hat. In a nod to convention, he would not have worn it indoors. Men did not do that then. Then again, men did not tend to walk out on their children in the middle of tourist attractions either, but that hadn't served to stop him. I guess my daddy picked his proprieties from a smorgasbord of options. He wore a watch and his wedding ring, too, and a belt with a silver buckle. He had surprisingly soft hands for a man. I had held his hand for the longest time, twirling his ring, until the darkness commandeered my attention when the lights were abruptly switched off. Then I just stood still, clutching that hand and willing him to protect me. Those large, soft hands that belonged to a man who would use them to wrest himself free of his daughter.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.